Well, he was connected to the point that...
He was getting referrals.
That another physician who might have had to report him may have had their income impacted by people who made decisions to make referrals. And I think that was a piece of it, certainly.
But Vicki, also what we're seeing is not only victims have difficulty reporting. Here we have a therapist who actually does do what he's supposed to do, does make the call, and he gets victimized just like the victims do.
Right.
So the question, so it's not that people didn't try to do the right thing during certain time periods. When we go back to the 1987 case, and that actually, back to the 1987 case, where the gentleman in Santa Rosa actually did report. And that's, and my name's Michael Stogner. I'm born and raised in San Mateo County, and I'm not a victim. I don't know any of the victims, but I'm very interested in the county doing what we should do to protect people and protect therapists when they do report and protect children when they do report and to not protect judges. So we actually have a no oversight of anything in San Mateo County up until in the very near future, as I hope to change, and I think a lot of people have changed. But when people do make their report, and for someone to say that case is closed, this person needs to at least have a place to go from there without jeopardizing his career.
Yeah.
We need to find out who said the case is closed, who actually did close the case, because obviously the case was closed by somebody.
Well, there's another aspect, the check. You don't want to talk about that?
The check?
The check, the $1,000 check.
Oh, yeah. So apparently, I forgot that. I forgot to mention it when I stood up. Apparently, after I made the report, and mind you that my client had only seen Ayres once, maybe twice, probably about a month or two after I made my report, my client's mother received a $1,000 check from Bill Ayres in the mail saying that he had looked at her file and I'd done some accounting and that he realized he had overcharged her. She disclosed to me that there was absolutely no way that he owed her any money.
So they told them to take it to the cops, right?
Yeah.
They turned it over to the police, and it's lost. That whole file is lost.
How does that
we don't understand that. That is odd. There's some question there. You know,
right.
Like many people or professionals, I've noticed this in other cases of child psychiatry that I've read, is that he cushioned himself so that when he was arrested, well, he couldn't have done that. He's, you know, friendly with that. That's what they do.
Doctors aside, the police department here should have picked up on that immediately and been tickled to death in the case of David Taylor. Coming from a police family, I have to tell you, I suspicion that. I don't know whether there's someone above them, or they're worried about their jobs, or maybe they're new chief, or, you know, like the doctors that used to work with Dr. Ayres. Why didn't they come forward? Some of them knew.
Well, I worked with cops on stories, and they're intimidated. They don't make as much money. This is just from what I've deduced, that they're intimidated by people with power and money, and, you know, and they're worried about the lawyers that they will have, you know, they can hire. And I remember one police officer said, well, I made a lot of enemies with this case. It's an odd thing, but you know, I've only seen Ayres a couple of times. I don't get it, but I don't live here, so I don't get what kind of, some kind of aura that made people not challenge him.
There was something about all of
them. Yeah.
You know, there's so many people that are involved in it, you know, that could be responsible. They're doing nothing else to be responsible. Or to the thing, you know, information of whoever sent their these kills to them.
My comment is a general comment. I've lived in San Mateo County for 50 years. And I occasionally flip through the book that says San Mateo County Medical Organization with photos of doctors. And you were always looking up around here, hearing, why not, you know, if you have a problem with the doctor, ethical billing, whatever, they have a peer program, which means if they ever heard of misconduct, they should fill out an 805 reporting form. In other words, how far would they take their peer review? They say they're revered for it. But when you go to the bottom of the form, if you have contacted the Medical Board of California or an attorney, they will not review your case. In other words, if your problem is more serious than a billing error, they will not listen to you.
I want to ask, in terms of alerting all of us in this room who care, I suppose we are already now so much better educated as to what to look for. But what kinds of advice would you give, say, therapists? What kinds of advice for professionals? What kinds of advice for parents?
You mean warning signs? Or?
Yeah.
Well, I found in terms of the thing about Ayres giving presents to kids, that's a classic with a priest, and that should be a, why is Ayres giving these presents to boys? I found one boy who was in hospitalized here, and what he told me, this is what he told me, is that on the weekends Ayres would come and take him out and buy him free record albums and a couple of action figures. This was back in the 60s, and that boy's having a hard time.
Yeah.
54 years old. So that's a huge red flag. Another one I found, there were strange rules. What I was told was that Ayres told one mother, don't wait in the waiting room. I don't like parents waiting in the waiting room. Has anyone ever heard of such a thing?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
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 Dr. Ayres
didn't have a
baby.
This
is
how
interesting.
He had a pattern. Really? And we weren't told when we first saw him that he does not work.
He doesn't talk to parents, and I have, you should, if he says that, there's on, where he was the president of the American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry, it says on their webpage that the child psychiatrist shall talk to the parents about treatment. And so, of course, you know, they're not going to talk, the kid is, it's supposed to be his private session, but I asked my friends who had 11, 12-year-old sons who were saying shrink, did their shrink ever say, don't ever ask what goes on? They said no, and that's another red flag.
Yeah.
Don't come too early. That's another one.
Did you ever have red flags from the children? What kinds of things might
have
be
acting different behavior?
If someone had Hannah up here, yeah. Respond.
Yeah, Jeff.
Sorry, don't make it.
Hi, Pat. I'm Becky Cooper, Executive Director of Friends for Youth. We've met over the years. And we are a longtime mentoring program in San Mateo County, and one of the first things, I've been with the program that long, and one of the first things when I first started this work, of course, was asking the question, how do you screen out inappropriate mentors? How do you identify predators? And 30 years ago, no one could really answer that question very well. So we've spent a lot of our time over the years. We produced a book that answers some of the questions you just asked. How do you identify potential predators? How do you screen people? What do you do? It's designed for community education. We're just starting to do some community work the last couple of years in San Mateo County, and they've supported a little bit of training. But we would love to get out and help spread awareness, which does start with parents quite often. Of
every probation officer, juvenile policy.
And,
that reminds me. I want to talk about, there's a woman that, Nita has a son called Corey, who is in state prison in Pleasantville. And one of the things I wanted to find were juveniles. The police did not have the files of juveniles. So because Alan had, the one who died, had been a juvenile, I felt special interest. And I felt that those boys would really not be believed. So I wanted to find them. Someone at a place called Juveniles Sentencing, something like that. She gave me her Nita's son's name because her son had talked to the press. He'd been in a program here. But I couldn't find him because in order to find someone in prison, you need their number, and I didn't have his number. So Nita had posted her son's poem on a website called Prison Talk. So I emailed her, and she said, why don't you write to Corey in prison and ask him, because he was at Hillcrest, and ask him if he remembers, and he was only about 23 at the time, and ask him if he remembered any of the guys who lived at Hillcrest, because maybe, you know, they'd be in statute.